Once again, I am repeating Section 10 of the Contract Act. Section 10 of the Contract Act is an important section because it contains all the ingredients that are necessary for forming a contract. So, all agreements or contracts, if they are made by free consent, competent parties for a lawful consideration and for a lawful object. So, if you want to enter into a contract, you require two parties. One person cannot enter into a contract unto himself. So, you require two parties, offeror and offeree. Two or more parties. So, here, two parties are required for entering into an agreement, which becomes enforceable by law. So, if you require the agreement to be enforced by law, the parties to the agreement must be competent. Section 11, for your information, I will read Section 11, which says, every person is competent to contract who is of the age of majority according to the law to which he is subject, and who is of sound mind and is not disqualified from contracting by any law to which he is subject. A person may, that is why I said, a person must be a person under law. All physical persons are not persons. Who is a person under law? A person under law is one who is capable of enforcing his rights against others, and others are capable of enforcing their rights against this person. So he alone is a competent person who is capable of exercising his rights under law. For example, you take a physically fit person like insolvent. An insolvent is not fit or competent to enforce any contract or enter into any contract. He is an insolvent. The law prohibits him. A convict, the law prohibits a convict from entering into a contract unless he gets the sanction from the court. Likewise, there are certain persons who are prohibited under law from entering into a contract. Now here, we must say that capacity to contract has to be viewed from two aspects. Incompetency may be on account of status, or incompetency may also arise on account of mental deficiency. Incompetency may arise on account of status, which under political aspects, a person may be a foreign sovereign, he may be an alien enemy, or he may be a convict or felon. These people are not considered as persons to enter into a contract as per law. Then, artificial, a corporation. What is a corporation? It is an aggregate persons. It is an association of persons recognized by law to discharge certain duties. So, you have got two types of corporations. Corporation sole and corporation corporation aggregate. Corporation sole and corporation aggregate. Corporation sole is the office which is handled by a single person. The mayor of Bangalore, the mayor of Chennai, king, queen, they represent the office, the president of India, the governor of the state. So they are all representing an office which could be adorned only by a single person. He is known as corporation soul. The Swamijis of Shankaramad, the chief head of the Shankaramad. Likewise, even among the Muslims also, the head of the Waqf board. So they are all representing the office. So long live Pope. Pope is the person who is actually heading the community of Christians. So you find they are all sole office, S-O-L-E. The sole office has got to be shouldered by one person. So this is what is known as corporation soul. That is why in England they say the king has expired, long live the queen. So that means the office has got to be permanent. Men may come and men may go, but the office will remain forever. So that is how it is defined. Then professional, on account of professional ethics, on account of professional rules and regulations, a person becomes incompetent to enter into a contract. So many people do not know the differences among these persons: advocate general, government leader, public prosecutor. These are the various posts that are actually given to persons to conduct their services of the state. For example, a government pleader. Who is a government pleader? A government pleader is one who argues for the government. Take for example, the Karnataka state. It appoints a government pleader. That government pleader is meant only for handling cases against the private parties by the Karnataka government. So any suit by the government against private parties, these suits have to be handled only by government pleaders. A government pleader cannot enter into a contract to appear for a private person. So he can only conduct the case against private persons, not for private persons against the government. Likewise, public prosecutor. Public prosecutor is a person who prosecutes, who conduct the prosecutions against the accused. So finally, he actually gets the penalty, award of penalty to the accused for having committed an offense. He is a public prosecutor, Crown prosecutor, state public prosecutor. Who is the advocate general? So many people do not know the difference between advocate general and government pleader. Advocate general is an advocate appointed by the central government. Whenever there is a clash between central government and the state government, for the purpose of arguing for the central government, advocate general will come to the picture. For the state government, government pleader will actually plead for the state's grievances. So, advocate general is a person who represents the office of the central government. And the government pleader, state government pleader, represents the office of the state government. That is the difference between advocate. Therefore, these people, an advocate general cannot enter into a contract with the state government for arguing the case against anyone, because he is already holding a service bestowed on him by the central government. So likewise, when there is a clash between the central government and the state government, advocate general will argue for the central government and the state government pleader will argue for the state. So this is the broad aspects which you have got to bear in mind. I will tell you later. Likewise, the next important aspect is marital. In marital, previously the women were disqualified. The women cannot actually enter into a contract. But now, after 1987, the women also are recognized to have equal share in ancestral property. And they can also enter into a contract with regard to the share in the ancestral property. Previously, only women had only right with regard to Sridhana property. We will talk about it later. So, on account of marital status, a woman previously was not allowed to enter into a contract. Then you have got the various aspects, as I told you, coming under the status. On account of the status, a person is not competent enough to enter into a contract. Now let us take mental deficiency. Mentally deficient person. So a person who is not having sound mind is considered to be a mentally deficient person. Now, according to section 12, sound mind itself has been defined under the Contract Act. What is meant by sound mind? Section 12 of the Contract Act speaks about sound mind. Who is said to have a sound mind? A person is said to be of sound mind
For what purpose? For the purpose of making a contract. If at the time when he makes it, he is capable of understanding it and forming a rational judgment as to the effect upon his act. Sir, I am not able to follow what is. A person is said to be of sound mind. Mere reading and writing, you cannot say this is nomenclature for a sound mind. I may read, I may write, I must understand. That is why in most of the agreements where a person is illiterate or a person, even he may be a literate person, I have read from para 1 to 12 and having understood the contents of the various writings or various things that have been incorporated in this agreement, I have signed after having understood and accepting the same. So, understanding, mere reading and writing is not enough. So, he should have understood. That is why a person is said to be of sound mind for the purpose of making a contract. If at the time when he makes it, he is capable of understanding it and forming a rational judgment. So, rational judgment means what? Reasonable judgment. What is good for him? What is beneficial for him? What is painful for him? He must be capable of understanding it. And after having understood the same, he should have signed it. So, sound mind. That is very important. So, here, on account of mental deficiency, a person may become incompetent to enter into a contract. What are the various categories under which a person becomes incompetent? Number one, infancy, minority. On account of a person being infant, he cannot enter into a contract. Second, a person on account of being an idiot. Who is an idiot? We say, you are an idiot. Who is an idiot? A person who is deaf and dumb. He is not able to speak. Not only is deaf and dumb, but is unable to understand. Deaf and dumb people, don't underestimate them. They can understand. A deaf person can be more intelligent. A dumb person may be more intelligent. You have Kosis, you would have seen a Hindi picture. So in that, how deaf and dumb people can also manage their life properly and they can behave very nicely. So deaf and dumb are not considered to be incompetent. They are also competent person provided they are able to form a rational judgment and use their reason. So idiocy. Lunacy means insane person. A person is declared to be insane. He is not able to understand anything around him and behind him or above him or in front of him. So here is a person who is insane. He has lost his sense. He is not having sound mind. Then drunkenness. It is temporary insanity. A person who is drunk, he cannot understand what he is saying. What is happening before him? He has completely lost his consciousness. That is why we say, I was completely not on my sense. So now only I am becoming sober. So that is why drunkenness, a person who is a drunkard cannot enter into a contract. He is not a competent person. Now, so far as first one, infancy. Infancy means minor. Who is a minor? A minor is not competent to enter into a contract because he is not a person under law. A person under law must be capable of enforcing his rights and rights are capable of being enforced against him. But a minor is not a person. Why minor is not a person? Because he is not able to exercise his reason. See, he is not worldly wise. He is not mature. He is an immature imbecile. He must say, I am humorously saying, he is not able to use his discretion. He will not be able to view everything with reason and caution. Because whatever is advised by a person, he will actually hear him and try to act upon it. But minor is not able to use his discretion and understand what is beneficial to him, what is painful to him. That is why he is not worldly wise. Under the Indian Majority Act,
of 18 under Indian Majority Act of 1745. I am sorry, the year you must remember properly. Under the Indian Majority Act of 1745, a minor is said to attain majority only when he, that is, I am sorry, here also, it is according to Indian Majority Act of 1845. I told 1745, it is wrong. 1845. According to Indian Majority Act of 1845, a minor becomes a major only after completing 18 years of age. But whereas under the Court of Odds Act, a minor becomes major only when he completes 21 years of age. Sir, what is this difference? Why the Indian government makes a difference between the age of minor under the Indian Majority Act and the Court of Odds Act of 1890? Now, you must understand, in case a minor is alive and he completes the age of 18, definitely he becomes a major if his parents are alive. Supposing the parents of minor, both the parents, unfortunately the minor happens to lose them in an air crash, then a person has got to be appointed as guardian. Court may appoint a guardian. In such of those cases where a guardian has been appointed under the Guardian and Wards Act, under 1890 Act, then in such cases the minor becomes major only after completion of the age of 21. That is why even marriage is possible only when a person attains the age of 21. Before completion of the age of 21, he cannot enter into a contract for marriage. So here you must understand who is a major. Now, such a minor is given extra protection under law. The privileges of the minor enjoys immunity. Now, as an eminent jurist said, they said that the law protects the minor. It preserves the property of the minor. It excuses the laches of the minor. Laches mean negligence. The advocates are said to be the pleaders. The judges are considered to be the counselors. And the court is said to be the guardian. Therefore, you must understand, the law is zealous, not jealous. Zealous, Z-E-A-L-O-U-S. The law is zealous to protect the minor, the interest of the minor. The law is not jealous. So, the minor occupies a special place under law. He is protected under law. So, that is why minor's contract is very important to know. So, a minor cannot enter into an agreement. Therefore, minor is incompetent to enter into a contract. But if a minor is prohibited from entering into a contract, how can a minor can eke out his livelihood? Supposing he wants food, he wants clothes to be supplied to him, necessaries that have got to be furnished to him, he has got to be educated. In all these aspects, a minor must be allowed to enter into a contract. So, you have got the Contract Act, which says what are all the circumstances under which a contract with a minor is said to be valid. What are all the circumstances under which a contract with a minor is said to be void? A contract with a minor is said to be valid for necessaries, number one. A contract with a minor is said to be valid for education, for the purpose of educating him. A contract with a minor is valid where the minor is under obligation to discharge his obligations, where a minor is under position to discharge his pious obligations. So these are the three circumstances under which a contract with a minor is said to be valid. What are the circumstances under which a contract with a minor is said to be invalid? A contract with a minor is said to be invalid when anything that is supplied to the minor is found not to be necessary. Then
A contract with a minor is said to be invalid when any loan has been advanced or any money has been given to him by way of loan. These are all the circumstances under which a contract with a minor is not said to be valid. A contract with a minor is said to be invalid for accounts stated. You cannot ask the accounts from a minor. So you give some money to the minor and ask him to give. No, you cannot. So these are the circumstances under which a contract with a minor is said to be invalid and valid. I will tell you about the circumstances under which a contract with a minor becomes valid. A contract with a minor is said to be valid for necessaries. What is necessaries? What do you mean by necessaries? Food, clothing and shelter. So food, clothing and shelter. That is, you have got roti, makan, kapda. These are the three things which are required for any person. They are basic necessities. If a minor is deprived of entering into a contract for obtaining these three things, minor will die. He will die out of starvation. Therefore, a contract with a minor is said to be valid for necessaries. Other than these things also, there are certain necessaries which varies according to the status and position of the minor. So what is necessary, what is luxury, what is sufficiency, is all relative terms. What is necessary for a modern boy is a luxury for people who belong to my generation. So a person cannot be without cell phone now. It is necessary for him. But olden days, we never had all these privileges and amenities. So what is necessary now may not be necessary in olden days. It's a luxury for them. So this is a relative term. So how law has got to view these aspects, we will now see by citing some leading cases. There is one case known as Ryder versus Umwelt. In this case, a minor was made to enter into a contract by a shopkeeper. After having understood a person as a minor, not even a person, we cannot say a person. After understanding that a particular chap happened to be a minor, the shopkeeper induced him to enter into a contract. For what? He induced the minor to enter into a contract for purchasing a pair of cufflinks, solitaires and golden goblet, golden cup. So the shopkeeper made the minor to purchase on credit a pair of cufflinks made out of gold studded with diamond and a golden cup, goblet. So what happened? The minor entered into a contract and purchased them and promised to repay. But the minor was having enough income. He had property worth about 20,000 pounds and he was getting monthly income of rupees 500 pounds. So the shopkeeper ascertained that the minor is creditworthy in order to enter into a contract. So he knew also, shopkeeper knew that the person who enters into a contract is a minor. Otherwise, he would not have taken such advantage. So when the minor never paid the money, automatically, what other relief the shopkeeper has? He filed a suit against the minor. Then the question came up, whether this contract with the minor is valid. Whether the goods supplied by the shopkeeper, are they necessaries? What are the goods that have been supplied by the shopkeeper? A pair of cufflinks made out of gold. The other article is golden goblet. That is a cup. When the minor was brought before the court, immediately the judge asked the minor, what about the cufflinks? Are you using the cufflinks? The minor showed his cufflinks to the court. Say, look here, I am wearing this. So the court was satisfied. The cuffling is actually worn by the minor. Then what about the golden goblet cup? I have given it to a friend of mine as a present. So the first court held that the cufflinks are necessary and golden cup is not necessary. But the shopkeeper, in order to succeed the case against the minor, He must prove. What he should prove? Both the cufflinks and cup, both of them are necessaries. Unless the shopkeeper is going to prove that both these articles are necessary and it is very much indispensable, essential to the miner, he will not succeed in his suit. The lower court said cufflinks are necessary because it is owned by the miner. Golden Goblet has presented it to somebody, robbing Peter and paying to Paul. So, well, that is not valid, that's it. But finally, the House of Lords said, both these articles are not necessary for miner. Do you mean to say that the shirt of the miner will not be kept intact by an ordinary cufflinks? Does he actually need a pair of cufflinks made out of gold and studded with diamond? And golden goblet, what is the use of presenting the golden goblet without using them, and he is presenting it to somebody else? What is the use of presenting a refrigerator to a person who is living in a hut where he has no access for electricity? So you must understand that not only what he gives to others must be of some benefit to the miner. So the court said both these things are unnecessary. Both the cufflinks as well as the golden goblet, namely the cup, both these things are unnecessary. That is why House of Lords very nicely concludes it by judgment. Is it necessary that a daily dinner of venison and turtle is required for a clerk who earns a meager salary of £7 a week? Not at all necessary. See, how can a person who earns very little money can aspire to spend so much of money? So, what is necessary? Necessary means indispensable. That which cannot be dispensed with. It is so essential, without which he cannot eke out his livelihood. That is what is known as necessaries. So, in this Rider versus Womwell, necessary means indispensable article. Then, the next important case is Robert versus Gray. That is what is known as education imparted to the miner. Any education, any skill, any game. In Robert versus Gray, a miner learned the art of playing billiards. See, in Robert versus Gray, the miner was taught as to how to play the game of billiards. The miner attained so much of proficiency that they used to arrange for funny games and games for the outsiders to come and witness and all that. So they used to watch the game being played by the coach and the miner, and they used to enjoy it. Now what happened? The miner was paid money by Mr. Roberts. He paid money also for the game which he played as a show game for others to witness. So, but it so happened that a miner one fine morning abruptly left the services of this coach and then went away. As a consequence of which, this Roberts actually was very much worried. And besides that, the miner was confronted with a question: why did you leave the services of Roberts? Because Roberts have not paid money, sir. He has paid a few for months. The rest of the months he never paid. So, I am entitled for recovery of the money, which I should have. So, that is what. But, however, here it is a case, not a question of money. Primarily, you understand, it is not a question of stipend. Robert has entered into a contract with Gray, namely the miner, to educate him, to teach him as to how to play the art of billiards. So, it is a question of imparting education. It is not a question of payment of stipend as you find in article the apprentice in chartered accountants firm. No, here is a question where a miner has been taught as to how to play the game of billiards. So, on the other hand, it is the miner who has got to pay the coach money. Therefore, Roberts filed a suit against the miner that he should pay. The court also said the miner should remunerate Roberts, the person who has taught him. So, a contract with a miner for imparting education is binding on the miner. There is yet another case where the question came up for consideration. That is the case of I'll just say.
Gupchan versus Baron. In this case, a dancing master taught the art of dancing to a dancing girl. But that girl misused the art of dancing and aked out her livelihood on account of this dancing in an immoral and illegal way. Then, when the dance master filed a suit against the person who has learnt the dance to pay the remuneration for him, then the girl contended, you see, this is for only for illegal and unlawful purposes. Then the court said, no, you might have used it for illegal and unlawful purposes, but the purpose for which the teacher has taught you the dance is to dance properly and eke out your livelihood decently. Therefore, any education imparted by the person to another for lawful purposes, lawfully and legitimately, has to be remunerated. Education imparted to the minor must be remunerated. Then, any pious obligation is also binding on the minor. Pious obligation means what? A legal obligation that is binding on a man. Supposing a minor succeeds to the estate of his father after the death of his father, some income tax money is due and payable, house tax is due and payable on that property. Can the minor say, no, I will not pay? See, I cannot actually enter into a contract with the government. He cannot say that, it is binding on him. Any obligation, that is, it becomes a charge over the property, and therefore minor is liable. Without paying the liability to the government, he cannot even succeed to the estate. So there is a legal obligation, pious obligation for family necessity. There is a daughter of a marriageable age. The minor is a minor, he has not attained majority. Now the daughter has got to be given by way of marriage. Now some expenses have got to be incurred. Therefore, the property is given by way of mortgage for family necessity and for seeing the daughter is married. The minor, after attaining majority, he cannot say, no, it is not binding on me. See, you have sent it only for the daughter's marriage. It is not. He cannot say that. That is a common property. It is a joint property. Everybody has got a right. It is binding on the minor. Had he become a major, it is his duty to give his sister by way of marriage. Therefore, any pious obligation is binding on the minor.